think the Europeans will like what they heard today, but it really, the target audience really is the American audience. It was a political speech more than a foreign policy speech. It was a good example of Obama's soaring rhetoric, his aspirational ability to inspire people. But it was lacking in specifics on what he is going to really ask of the Europeans, and the Germans in particular, if and when he becomes president. So while it was a good speech, it does not rank at the top of the list of the speeches he's given in this campaign so far.
Well, he at least was asking them to send troops to Afghanistan, wasn't he?
Well, I don't think he specifically talked about the real problem that the German military presence in Afghanistan presents, which is that there are a series of caveats, there are a series of restrictions on what they can do. And that's the hard case to be argued between the United States and the Germans, and he did not touch it today. And I can understand why. This was a political gathering. It was an occasion to project an image of Europeans, the rest of the world, eager for the change that he promises. So I understand why he didn't want to take on that degree of a difficult subject, but at the same time, he may have missed an opportunity.
An opportunity to point to specific ways that the division can be healed, rather than just saying there is the division and we must heal it.
I think that's right. He did have that opportunity today, and he chose to play it in a more political vein than in a policy vein. Again, that's quite understandable. But it does detract a little bit from the value of this occasion.
Robin, I'll come to the Middle East in a moment. Talk first today in Europe in this speech.
Well, I thought it was actually a pretty effective speech. He had tremendous humility. I think that played to European concerns about American arrogance over the past 8 years. I think he also appealed to the Europeans in the sense they differentiate between American policy and the American people. And he came across as an American who, proud of his nation, wanted to set America on a new course that agreed more with European priorities. He mentioned the environment. He mentioned things that are not necessarily on the top of our agenda, but are on the top of the European causes.
Ethan?
I would agree. I mean, I don't know that Jim is right that he needed to make some more specific policy statements. It seems to me that the large issue in his candidacy is he's a guy who says, I'm going to bridge differences. I'm as much a symbol as a man of substance. And as a symbol in Germany today, he was pretty effective. I thought that the whole idea of the tearing down of walls, I mean, the implied message being that another wall can get torn down by electing me, although, as Robin said, very humbly presented, and not in any way. And he said he came as a citizen, not as a candidate. Of course, that's false, but that's fine.
How much will a new president, if it is Barack Obama, be able to, by his sheer presence and persona, change the attitude that exists in many areas of the world about America?
Well, as Ethan was suggesting earlier, Barack Obama, if he is elected, is going to benefit greatly from the last 8 years of George W. Bush and the attitudes abroad about Bush. People will certainly be disappointed. The euphoria will begin to evaporate. But they will also compare him to Bush and probably feel relieved that he's there, at least for a while. He will have a honeymoon period. There is a great romance in Europe, in particular, about Obama. And about what he represents about America. It's not only about Obama. It is about an America that can be anything, can do anything, is full of surprises, both good and horrible, for Europe in particular, but for the world at large. We have concentrated on the Middle East and on Europe. We shouldn't leave out Asia, because I don't think Obamamania extends in Asia the way it does here. And it's largely because of an issue we haven't discussed, and that's trade,
right,
which will be very important in the world's reaction. And both in Japan and in China, you see governments that have become very comfortable with George W. Bush on trade and on Asian policy will regret Bush to some extent. It's true for India as well, and therefore are probably friendlier toward McCain than they are toward Obama at this point. And they should be remembered as well.
I tend to think that that Obama, if he is elected, faces three really critical problems in his first year. that is going to deflate the balloon. And the first one is Iran. The Bush administration is probably not going to take military action, particularly in the aftermath of the national intelligence estimate. There's not the will, particularly either in the Hill, in the military, or in the public, to do something before he leaves office. But as the Iranians, if they continue to defy the international community and continue to work on centrifuges and enriching uranium, which can be used for a nuclear weapon, that then becomes a test, maybe even the first test for the next president. Then there's the issue of Afghanistan. If it continues on the current trajectory, and that's getting nastier, far nastier than Iraq is, in terms of human life, as well as the kind of volatility. And then there's Pakistan, and the two are interrelated. And the fact is the new Pakistani government has not proven to be very strong, even though democratically elected, in dealing with the age-old problem of terrorism along that common border where Osama bin Laden is believed to be hiding. And the U.S. has up until now used air power to try to attack people, cells, groups, suspected extremists along that border. But that's not very popular in Pakistan right now, and that could lead to the turning of Pakistan against the United States. And a democratically elected government is going to feel more pressure to respond to that than a military dictator like General Musharraf is. So these are three problems that could force Obama to make some very tough choices if he's elected, or Senator McCain if he's elected.
Let me close with this. Whoever's elected the next president, whether it's John McCain or Barack Obama, what's the biggest challenge he faces?
I think Rob did a pretty good job laying them out. I think Iran is by far the biggest because it also involves, it sucks in Israel and the Palestinians and Lebanon in a way that, you know, Rob didn't have a chance to get into right there, but is clearly the case. I mean, it's sort of the unifying issue that Israel is most worried about with regard to Hamas and with regard to Hezbollah and, of course, with regard to Syria. All of the issues that are going on in the Middle East come back ultimately to Iran, and the question of whether the Arab League offer, for example, to Israel should be taken up and discussed is also worth thinking about in terms of what it would mean for Iran's nuclear ambitions and Iran's general ambition in the region. I mean, one thing that, you know, we haven't had a lot of chance to talk about is whether or not Israel might act unilaterally against Iran. And I would have to say it is not out of the question by any means.
Join us online at charlierose.com.